Here's another Houdini node. Let's dive in and check it out.
Vellum Rest Blend. This is super useful. It lets you morph between different rest states of geometry, updating the constraints for you. So you get some really nice vellum behavior instead of a static blend shape. There are two different Vellum Rest Blend nodes, the SOP level and the DOP level. Let's build both and look at the differences. Let's start with the box. We'll increase the scale to 2. And then we're going to add a poly bevel to round the edges. Let's use a distance of 0.1 and let's give it 4 divisions. Next, we're going to use a remesh to get some nice uniform triangles across our entire mesh. And we're going to use a target size of 0.1. Next, we want to create a sphere that we're going to morph to. So we'll create a sphere and we want to make sure that it's slightly smaller than our box, which it is by default, which is great. So we'll change it to a polygon type and we'll give it a few more subdivisions so that it's a nice smooth sphere. Next, we're going to use a ray SOP to ray our box onto our sphere so that we have the same point count from our box onto our sphere. We can change the method to minimum distance, and now our box has been shrunk down onto our sphere. If we use just a null to visualize without the blue guided geometry, we can see that the box is now in fact rayed onto the sphere. But our triangles are very closely stuck together. So what we can do now is use a smoothing SOP to try and push the triangles apart just a little bit. A setting of 50 is perfect. Next, let's add our vellum cloth. You can use a vellum balloon or even a strut soft body if you want different behavior, but for now we'll just stick to cloth. The only thing we're going to change is we're going to reduce the bend stiffness just a little bit. Next, we'll add a vellum solver. Let's jump up to 4 substeps. And we're also going to add in a ground position plane so that we have something for our falling sphere and cube to interact with. The next thing that we want to do is we want to introduce our vellum rest blend. So we do that in between our cloth constraint and our vellum solver. We plug that in. And the first and second inputs are for the geo and constraints. And the fourth input is for the target position of our geometry. So we're feeding in our sphere, but we actually want to morph to our cube. So we plug that into the fourth input. Let's just do a little bit of tidying up on our scene. Now we have a slider in this vellum rest blend. And a value of 0 does nothing, and a value of 1 means go as much as you can to this target shape, which in our case is a cube. And a value of 0.5 is somewhere in between. Try and become the cube, but also maintain a little bit of the sphere. And you can see it's a little bit more wobbly and more spherical. This looks great. However, it's a fairly sudden change as it snaps all the constraints to the target shape on frame 2. Because we cannot animate this blend slider on the SOP level. Let's take a look at how we can modify this setup to increase it gradually over time and have more control. We'll continue from our current scene. And what we'll do is we'll remove the vellum rest blend on the SOP level and we'll add a reference null after our cube and let's call it out_blend. Everything else is exactly the same, so let's dive inside our vellum solver. Here we can add a vellum rest blend. We want to change the update frequency to each frame. This will evaluate the rest blend every frame instead of only once. Next, we want to change the source to SOP. Now we can look up that reference null that we created. The great thing with the vellum rest blend is that we can now animate the blend and it'll update each frame. So we can control when and how slowly we want our rest blend to happen. Let's push the setup just a little bit further. Let's introduce a falloff into our blend. In order to do this, we want to blend the shape on SOP level and then feed this into the vellum rest blend. So the first thing we'll do is we'll dive into the vellum solver and we'll remove the keyframes on the blend shape and we'll just set it to a value of 1. The next thing, we want to keep this null that our vellum rest blend is referencing, but we need to add a few things in between. Let's drop down an attribute wrangle and we're going to use just a little bit of code to blend between our two shapes. Let's plug our sphere into the first input and our cube into the second input. We're going to use the lerp function to update our position between the two shapes. If you hit F1 on any function inside of Vex, it gives you the help page, which is really useful to see what arguments each function needs. In this case, we need 2 vectors and an amount. So for now, we'll just use A and B for our 2 vectors, and our blend amount will be called bias. Let's set up 2 vectors, A and B. And then we're going to set up a float variable called bias. For vector A, we're going to use a point function to look up the position of all the points that are coming in on the second input, which in our case is the cube. We need to define a integer PT, which in our case is just the point number. Our vector B is the current position, in this case, our sphere. And the bias is going to be a mask attribute, which we don't have yet, so let's quickly create that. Usually for falloffs, I would use mops falloff, but in this case, we'll create it slightly differently in case you don't have mops installed. We'll create a box, and we want to create a box slightly bigger than our original box. We'll then use a transform to animate the box on. This is going to act as our animation transformation. So let's move forward a few frames and set a keyframe. Then we'll go back a few frames, move our box away, and set another keyframe. We're going to use a mask from geometry, which is very similar to an attribute transfer, except it gives us a nice solid fill attribute. Let's plug our original geometry into input 1 and our cube into input 2. If you click the little visualize button, you can see the masked attribute traveling through our shape. Now let's plug this into the first input of the attribute wrangle. And you'll see I've made a few errors. We need to add some semicolons into our code. Each line needs to end with a semicolon. Now, as we scroll through, you can see it's morphing from the cube into the sphere. But this is actually in reverse. We want to morph from the sphere into the cube. So let's just invert the remap in the mask from geometry. And now we get what we want. And because the reference null is still being referenced in Vellum Rest Blend, we can hit play on Vellum and we should get exactly what we want. And if we turn off gravity, we can get the nice transition without it falling onto the ground. This really is just the tip of the iceberg when it comes to using Vellum Rest Blend. You can try different noises and different falloffs. There are so many cool things to do. Why don't you jump in and give it a go? It's Houdini time.